earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the earth and all who live in it. And so may we celebrate God our Creator as we celebrate a Jubilee for the earth. Good morning, my name is Mitchell Anderson. I am the lead minister here at St. Paul's United Church. And a few weeks ago, I lost a bet. I am a deep fan of the Montreal Canadiens. My ancestors settled in New France. I am literally descended from des habitants to des habitants, so I cheer for the Habs. But as you may know, the Montreal Canadiens lost their series with the Flyers, and so here I am wearing a jersey because I lost that bet. But there's an upside. It is the perfect color for our new church season, the season of creation. The season of creation is a time in the church year we take in the Northern Hemisphere's fall, where we talk about our relationship with the earth and with nature and how that reveals to us who God, our good Creator, is. And the color we use to celebrate this season is orange. So at least that fits. And as we gather today celebrating the season of creation, our theme for this season is a Jubilee for the earth. We are part of something called the World Council of Churches, which brings together hundreds of churches all over the world. And this year, all those churches are celebrating this season of creation, a Jubilee for the earth. And as we gather here in this place, we are in the territory of Treaty 6, in the homeland of the Métis Nation, where people have stewarded creation and live with respect with all people and all creatures for thousands of years. And in this tradition, we continue. Our bedrock belief today is that Jesus Christ is our teacher and our role model. As Jesus welcomed all people, so too do we. As Jesus pointed to the creation to invite people to understand God, our Creator, so too will we. Jesus Christ is our teacher and our role model. And so if you have a candle with you at your home, I'll invite you to take it and light it with us. This candle symbolizes that Jesus Christ is present here with us, that as its light shines and fire burns, so too we know that in the things of creation, in fire and in light, we encounter Jesus Christ, who is for us and for all the world.
Let's sing it together. Here we go.
You are holy, you show us the way. 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 You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You are freedom, 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 you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way.
Justice.
You are justice, you show us the way. 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 You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. You show us, you show us, you show us the way. My soul is thirsting for you, oh God.
Scripture reading today is taken from the story of the Exodus. Our God says, "Tell the whole Israelite community, on the 10th day of this month, they must take a lamb for each household, a lamb per house. If a household is too small for a lamb, it should share one with a neighbor nearby. You should divide the lamb in proportion to the number of people who will be eating it. Your lamb should be a flawless year-old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You should keep close watch over it until the 14th day of this month. At twilight on that day, the whole assembled Israelite community should slaughter their lambs, and they should take some of the blood and smear it on the two doorposts and on the beam over the door of the houses in which they are eating. That same night, they should eat the meat roasted over the fire. They should eat it along with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Don't eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and internal organs. Don't let any of it remain until morning, and burn any of it left over in the morning. This is how you should eat it. You should be dressed with your sandals on your feet and your walking stick in your hand. You should eat the meal in a hurry. It is the Passover of the Lord." Let us pray. God, as we celebrate this season of creation, more and more we seek to know who you are and all the ways that you are good. More and more we seek to mark this time a jubilee for the earth, a time for freedom and forgiveness, a time for abundance, a time to celebrate. God, we pray that we might hear from these ancient stories wisdom for our time, that as our ancestors in faith sought to follow you to freedom, so too might we. And may we know, God, that it is not our work to bring freedom for the earth, to bring about this jubilee. It is your free gift that you offer to us and to all creation. And so we say, oui, Seigneur, tu es bon. Yes, Lord, you are good. Oui, Seigneur, tu es bon. Amen.
Oui, Seigneur, tu es bon. Oui, tu es ma force. Oui, Seigneur, tu es bon. Alléluia. Oui, Seigneur, tu es bon. Oui, tu es ma force. Oui, Seigneur, tu es bon.
That you are contributing to the life of this church as we seek to join God in God's mission of making all things new. I want to thank the volunteers as hosts and in worship team and in the board and many others who have done the work to get us ready to welcome some people back into our space this morning and in weeks ahead. I want to thank all the people up here with me on stage and on tech and hosting and everyone who's made this day possible. And I want to thank each and every one of you for your contributions to the life and work of St. Paul's United Church. I know it's been a hard time these last months, but through your generosity and faithfulness, we continue to do our good work, the good work that God gives to us. If you're able to make a contribution, probably the best way would be to offer us an e-transfer, to send an e-transfer to the church. If you're not too sure how to do that, or if you need some help, send our Facebook page a message, or send us an email, or find me, or whatever you need to do, and someone will be very happy to help you. We thank you for these gifts, and in this time of the season of creation, we thank God for all the gifts that we're blessed with, for gifts of harvest and food and family, the gifts that make our life possible. I'll invite us now to consider our seed of learning today. Our question as we begin the season of creation is there somewhere in nature that helps you feel free? Somewhere in nature where you feel free, whatever free means to you. I grew up in Meadow Lake in the northwest of this province, and I feel the most myself and the most free when I am in the forests like the ones that I grew up in. When I can hear the wind blowing through trees, when I can see lakes, when I am surrounded by that part of the world, that kind of nature, that particular part of God's good creation that nurtured me, that sustains my soul. That's where I feel the most free. I'll invite you, if there's a place in nature where you feel free, to share that as a Facebook comment. If there's a story you want to share, that would be wonderful. And as you're doing that, I'll throw out that question for our seed of learning to those here in our building and those with me on stage. If there's anyone who has a place in nature where you feel free.
There is, Mitchell. As a child, I grew up in Melville, and we spent a great deal of time in the Qu'Appelle Valley. Really quiet time was to climb the hill behind the cabin and just sit quiet in the short grass and just listen to all of nature around, not unlike what you were doing, and to just watch the lake in its peacefulness. It was always serene.
Beautiful. Yeah. Thank you. We have some comments, Mitchell, and I would like to share a couple from Cheryl and others. From Cheryl, in my own backyard. Good. And actually, that was one of my stories. There was a time when Brittany and I were on our way to Cheryl's in Cheryl and Marty's in Ferndale, and that was a time we just were able to kick back, relax, and be free. And there's not many opportunities for many people. And from Bev Rutherford, as I have mentioned before, my grandpa's farmyard is my place.
Amazing.
That's a fact. And I know there are other comments coming in, but you know what? Maybe we can come back to these as the service progresses as well.
Thank you. Our second scripture reading today is taken from the first letter of St. Peter. It is written, "You shall be holy, for I am holy. And if you call upon the Father and Mother who judges each one of our actions without preference, without prejudice, then you should conduct yourselves with honor during the time of your journey. You were not set free by silver or gold or anything like that that decays and perishes, that you inherited from the empty traditions of past generations. No, you were set free by the precious blood of Christ, our pure and flawless Lamb. Even before the making of creation, Jesus was known and chosen as the one who would be revealed to us in these late times. And you, who through Christ trust in the God who raised Christ up from death and gave Christ glories, you should now place your faith and your hope in God." Let us.
And just before you pray, Mitchell, I think this is going to tie in really well. From Dorian and Elaine, "We feel free in all kinds of nature, but especially by the ocean, watching the power and the beauty of the water." And from Nancy Maloney, "Yes, Mitchell, outdoors on a walk, hearing the birds, but especially for us in the north at our trailer, amongst the trees, hearing and seeing all the sights and sounds of nature." And from our friend Kara, from Camp
Capawingo at
Vesper Hill, "Nowhere has more peace for me than sitting in that spot overlooking the lake." Thank you, Kara. And from Maddie Burns, "Nature in general, but my place to feel at peace is at my grandparents' lake, sitting on the dock on the quiet water."
Thank you for those stories. Let us pray. God, we ask that as we hear these stories of our ancestors, of their yearnings for freedom, may we have a stirring in our heart that we might ache too for the freedom that you are promising us and through us to the whole creation. Amen. So if I had to pick a book of the Bible that was my favorite, it would probably be Exodus. I just love the story. I love how important women are to the narrative of the story, how God chooses women to be God's partners throughout the story of Exodus, how Moses' mother offers him to the river, how the midwives refuse to kill the baby Hebrew boys even when Pharaoh tells them to do so, how Miriam, Moses' older sister, is described as a prophet who leads the whole people in singing praise to God, and how Moses' wife, Zipporah, is the only one who gets it when Moses has abandoned God and who brings him back to his great calling. And I love how rich the imagery of Exodus is. I love how when God parts the waters for the people to go through the Red Sea, the story says that God blows out of God's nostrils. I love the image of God blowing out of God's nostrils to set the people free. It's such a rich imagery of who God is. I love imagining the taste of manna or the taste of quail in the desert or drinking miraculous water when we are thirsty and knowing that our God is good. And I love the story at the very heart of Exodus that tells the whole story that frames it, that our God is a God of freedom, a God of justice, a God who always seeks to set the people free. God has never forgotten the promises that God made to our ancestors, the promises that God made to Sarah and Abraham and their descendants forever. And so God acts decisively in human history, always on the side of freedom. God is not neutral in situations of injustice, but God is always, always on the side of the excluded, the marginalized, and the oppressed. And so in the story of Exodus, God acts. God lifts up leaders like Miriam and Moses and Aaron. God works through unnamed people like the midwives who rescue the babies. God works even through unexpected people like foreigners, like Zipporah. God works through all kinds of people, but always for one purpose, for freedom. And so the reading that we had today is an important part of that story. And I know it's sometimes a hard story, the story of the 10 plagues, to imagine God punishing people. And it's okay to struggle with that. It's okay to struggle with the idea of God sending a messenger of death to kill the firstborn offspring of all the people. Indeed, this is a difficult story, but it's part of the story that we do need to wrestle with, because it frames this powerful moment that shapes the life of the people, that they are to take a lamb, flawless, and they are to share it together with their neighbors, to eat it, and to mark their doorways of their house and the beam on the top with its blood, so that the angel of death, the messenger that God sends, will pass over those houses as the angel goes about their mission. And then they are told to have their sandals ready, their walking stick in their hand, to eat the meal in a hurry, because it is the Passover of the Lord. And when dawn comes, they will leave. They will go to freedom because God is rescuing them. And so it's a hard story, but it's an important story because it's our story too. And when Jesus' first followers were trying to understand what happened when Jesus died on the cross, they turned to their stories, the stories of their traditions, the stories of their ancestors. They turned to stories like the story of the Passover, and they began to describe Jesus as being like a lamb, being like the Passover lamb, flawless, without sin or blemish in any way. And that just as Jesus' blood came out upon the cross, it's the same way that as Jesus' blood marked the wood of the cross is the same as the lamb's blood marking the wood of the door. And the same thing is that God is here to rescue us. God is here to set us free. And this is, I think, an important image for us to hold on to, the story of the Exodus, because it tells us who God is. God is always leading people to freedom. God is always leading people to justice. And it's the same thing that God is doing in Jesus. After the people wander in the Exodus for 40 years in the wilderness, they find their way into the promised land. And as they've wandered, God has given them instructions, rules, laws, you could call them, on how they're going to live a different kind of life. That if they were slaves in Egypt in the promised land, they will be free. That if in Egypt they had to work every day as they were enslaved, in this new land they will take every seventh day as a day of rest. And they will take every seventh year as a year to let the whole land lie fallow. And every seven cycles of these 7 years, they will mark a year of Jubilee. And that's what we're exploring this season of creation, is what would it mean for now to be a Jubilee for the earth, a Jubilee for all of creation, that as God seeks to rescue, as God brings freedom, what would it mean for in our time, God to be bringing freedom and justice to the whole earth? And so I believe two things. First, when I wrote the first draft of my sermon, I had a lovely passage about how we had to go out and help build a more inclusive and free and just society. And I realized as I finished that I'd made a terrible mistake. The story of Exodus isn't the story of Moses going and getting things done. It's the story of God getting things done. And so in our time, the Jubilee for the earth is not our job to do, it's what God is already doing. God is always rescuing. God is always bringing freedom. And our task is to celebrate what God is doing and to go and to join what God is already doing, not to take God's work on ourselves. And so that's an important lesson for me. It's an important lesson for all of us. In the United Church, we are doers of the word. We like to go out and get things done, take charge and take things into our own hands. But the story of the Exodus reminds us that we depend on God, that God is the actor, not me and not you. God is the one who brings freedom. God is the one who rescues. God is the one who brings justice. And as God rescued the people from Egypt, so too, in Jesus dying for us on the cross, Jesus, the Lamb of God, dying for the sins of the world, Jesus marking the wood of the cross with his blood, just as the Lamb marked the wood of the doors of the Hebrew people with its blood. So too, then, we are celebrating this time a Jubilee for the earth. That Jubilee means freedom, and that God is rescuing not just us, but the whole creation to bring freedom and justice to the earth. Amen. We are celebrating today the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, the Eucharist. We give it many names, this ritual, and it is the very heart of our faith. I'll invite you to have, those of you who are at home, something like wine or juice and something like bread. And those of us here in the church building will take our little prepackaged cups to keep us safe during COVID times. What we celebrate here is not the table of St. Paul's. It's not the table of me as your minister. This is the table of the Lord. And so all are welcome. God is the one who welcomes you here. And God rescues and sets free and welcomes everyone. And so we'll invite all who come are welcome to receive. And so let us celebrate the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us praise the Lord.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good to praise you, God, because you are our good creator. You made all things to work together, and you called them good. And even before the making of the world, you sent Jesus. Through Jesus and through Christ, you made all things and marked all things as holy. Our ancestors in faith, our ancestors lost their way. They chose selfishness. They chose many things that led them away from you. But you never abandon us. You never forget the promises you make to us. And so, with all creation, we praise you as we sing.
Oh, holy, holy, holy God, oh God of time and space, all earth and sea and sky above bear witness to your praise. Hosanna in the highest heaven, creation sings your praise. And blessed is the one who comes and bears your name always.
And in the fullness of time, to renew your creation, you came yourself as Jesus, our brother. He drank water, he breathed air, he walked upon the earth, he was part of the creation. And by his living amongst us, by being born into the creation, he marks all creation as holy. By being willing to challenge all the forces that divide and hurt, he names that your intention, good, our good God, is to make all things new. As he dies for us, our Lamb of God, he shows that you are bringing all things to freedom. And so, remembering all of who Jesus is, the Lamb of God by whose blood we are set free, we remember how the night Jesus was betrayed, that he took bread. He offered thanks and broke it, just as his body would break upon the cross for our healing. And he offered the bread to his friends, saying, as we now say together,
take and eat. This is my body, broken for you and for the world. Each time you do this, remember me.
In the same way, after the meal, Jesus took a cup of wine. He offered thanks and poured it into a cup, just as his blood would pour out upon the ground for our freedom. And he offered the wine to his friends, saying, as we now say together, take and drink. This is my blood poured out for you and for the world, for the forgiveness of sins, blood for a new covenant. Each time you do this, remember me. And so, remembering who Jesus is for us and for the world, and who he calls us to be, his people sent into the creation, may we mark this holy time of Jubilee, freedom for the land and for all creation. And we offer ourselves as we sing together the mystery of our faith.
See, Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again. See, Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so we pray, Holy Spirit, send yourself out upon these gifts here. Send yourself out upon this people gathered and this people in many places. May we be joined together and may we be transformed into your body, just as we pray these gifts be transformed into the body and blood of Jesus Christ. As Jesus breaks his body to bring all creation wholeness, may we too be ready to break our bodies for the wholeness of creation. As Jesus pours out his blood for the healing of the world, may we too be ready to pour out our blood for the healing of the world. And God, we pray for your world. It is so good, but there's so many parts that are touched by violence and injustice. There's so many people who are hurting and afraid and lonely in this time. We pray for them all, God. We pray that your Spirit might bring about renewal and transformation, not just at this table, but in all your creation. That your Spirit might transform us to be instruments of healing and creations mending everywhere we go. And God, when we are hurting or afraid, may this meal that we taste together strengthen us and nourish us for the great work that you are already doing, and welcome us to join you as we go to the many places that you are sending us. God, we lift up these prayers for your world, these prayers for your church, these prayers for ourselves. Lift up all these prayers as we say together the prayer that Jesus teaches us. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen, amen, O Holy One, Hosanna and amen. Amen, amen, O Holy One, Hosanna and amen. Amen, amen, O Holy One, Hosanna and amen. Amen, amen, O Holy One, Hosanna and amen.
So for those who are here with us in person, I'll invite you to take a little piece of bread. And for those at home, I'll invite you to take what you have for bread and know that this is Jesus Christ, broken for us and for the world, and so we eat. In the same way, I'll invite those of us here to take the juice, and those of you at home to take your wine or your juice, and to consume, knowing that this is Jesus Christ poured out for us and for the world. And as we have feasted at this table, as the Holy Spirit has transformed these gifts to be the body and blood for us, so too we are transformed to be the body of Christ. And so as we go, we say together our blessing. Mark this time as holy. Celebrate the time of Jubilee.
announce freedom to the earth, freedom to all who live in creation. Bring justice to all people, for now is the time of Jubilee. Amen.
Go make a difference.